Hello, thanks for joining me on Life and Surround, as it is still time to memorialize the late, great Neil Peart around here. Today we're going to be discussing the 2012 5.1 remix of 2112 by Rush. Okay, 2112. So much could be said. Many Rush fans are already familiar with its history, but I'll briefly recap some highlights for you now. Inexplicably, the world did not take to the 1975 album Caress of Steel. It's an amazing album, it is quirky, it has heavy moments, it has light moments, it definitely is greatly inspired by progressive rock. It has sprawling epics, the entire side B is the Fountain of Lamneth, along with Necromancer, occupying around 12 and a half minutes of side A. Rush, in particular Neil Peart, considered it to be somewhat of a juvenile effort, and he felt that Rush didn't really hit their stride until Moving Pictures. Still, Caress of Steel is greatly loved by many, but it was panned by critics and it didn't sell well, and even the tour in support of it didn't go well. It was called the Down the Tubes Tour. So fast forward to their need to produce a winning effort for the next album, 1976. Rush had a make-or-break moment. They were pressured by their label to put out singles, but instead they responded with 2112. They doubled down on their exploration of sidelong epics, this time devoting side A of their album to a rock space opera. Fortunately, it really hit a nerve with enough rock fans that attendance at their shows began to swell and the record sold well, and it even prompted increased sales of their previous three albums. They did not give the record label the singles they were looking for, but they did give rock fans, progressive fans, and Rush fans absolutely what they were craving. Side A of 2112 is heavily inspired by the writings of Ayn Rand, and it really is a statement about how the guys were feeling at the time. In their effort to achieve artistic freedom and not conform to record label demands and become just another product of the music industry, they wanted to be unique. They wanted to be free. And 2112 was their answer. Fortunately, it became their breakthrough album. And in 2012, exactly 100 years prior to the setting of 2112, so I call that the pre-centennial, we received 2112 5.1. Mixed by Richard Chycki, with a few bonus tracks on the CD, and the high-res stereo and 5.1 album on Blu-ray. It's also available in a CD-DVD audio format, and with both formats, you get to watch a comic book of the album unfold, which is just an incredible experience. I love it every time. I wish they had done this with A Farewell to Kings, with Cygnus X1, with Hemispheres. Bottom line up front, I recommend it. Go grab it while you can. Prices are still sane, but they may not be forever. Typically, I talk about the music, the mix, and the sonics of surround albums on this channel. I'm not sure there's really a need to talk much about the music of 2112. It's absolutely iconic. Several years ago, it was made a national treasure by Canada. It's superb. It's heavy and dense in the right places. It's light and acoustic in others. It's experimental. It's purposeful. It's focused. It's nerdy, but you know, somehow endearing and accessible to a great many people. It's just an incredible album. It is part of the early era of Rush, so it tends to be like solidly rooted in some classic rock inspirations. It's heavily pentatonic. It's not overly dissonant. Rush tended to get very complex and dissonant and unique and well worthwhile in their later period, But there's something about the youthful simplicity of a lot of their early work that is very compelling for me. And I'm not meaning to call Rush simple as a broad brush. There's plenty of complexity in 2112, in Caress of Steel, Fly By Night, Farewell to Kings, Permanent Waves. That's absolutely true. But I just feel like a lot of their early work has a lot in common with their early influences, and I connect a lot with those same bands, and so there's something very magical and special about early Rush. Let's touch on the Sonics real quick. 2112 5.1 sounds really nice. I've played it on my home theater system, and I've played it on my full range listening system. And parts of it are revelatory. You're going to hear things that you never have before. It feels generally well balanced, clear. It feels mainly like the LP that we've all grown to know and love, but spread out in the room around you, with one exception, and I'll get to that in just a second. All right, so the meat and potatoes of this channel, let's get into that 5.1 mix. I'll start off with what I think is the biggest failure of this mix. There's the somewhat buried 1812 Overture guitar overdub homage from the Overture part of 2112. I feel that it's a fun and important part of the music, connecting the present to the past, while lyrically 2112 explores the future. Here's an example of what I'm talking about from the original stereo mix. And here it is from the fronts of Richard Chycki's 5.1 mix. But somehow on every system that I've played this on, that 1812 homage gets buried. I think maybe it needed to be supported a little better in the center and in the surrounds. And that leads me to a point that I'd like to make about this 5.1 mix. I agree with some other listeners that 2112 is not quite as effective as Chycki's Fly By Night. And as I've said in a previous video, I consider Fly By Night to be Richard Chycki's most successful 5.1 mix. I think the reason why 2112 is a little bit less effective is that he had more tracks to work with. 2112 in many places feels more dense to me. I think instead of having maybe two guitar tracks to work with, Chycki at times has 6 or 8 guitar parts to work with. So by the time you spread that all around the room and all around the listener, you're going to run the risk of overshadowing some parts and creating more or less a dense experience rather than what feels like a discrete experience to the listener. Now, there are plenty of discrete moments in this mix, and we'll get to that now. So we'll start off by just talking about what does appear in the surrounds. The waterfall effects from Discovery and from Soliloquy. Acoustic guitars. Guitar overdubs. Cymbals from what I like to think of as the edge of the drum kit. Lead guitar sometimes makes its way back there, particularly during grand finale when the guitar goes crazy. Vocals, particularly when Geddy doubles his vocal. And as for the center, it's mainly occupied by lead vocal, which is somewhat wet, and kick drum and snare drum. And let's talk about some surround highlights track by track. Overture, you get some swirly keyboard effects whizzing around you during that synthy intro that's so distinctive. Passage to Bangkok, you get the Asian-style chimes that play that Asian-esque melody. Twilight Zone, you get Geddy's whispers in the surrounds, a lot like The Doors, Riders on the Storm. Lessons, you get some guitar overdubs that are fairly distinctive. Tears, you get Mellotron, played by Hugh Syme. He He was not only the artist of many of their album covers, but he appears on 2112 playing Mellotron. And while Tears may not be a favorite of a whole lot of fans, I absolutely love it. It's emotive, and I feel like it just perfectly sets up that ultra-classic rock guitar introduction of Something for Nothing. Those chimey guitars that intro the song are beautifully spread out around the room, so that intro is unlayered for you, and you hear electrics, acoustics, and even 12-string, I believe, distinctly from each other. And it just makes the introduction of Something for Nothing just a jaw-dropping, awesome moment for this 5.1 album. Bass guitar hangs out in the front, left, and right, as does most of the drum kit. Lots of guitars, and support for the lead vocal. I think my overall criticism of this 5.1 mix is that at times I wish the drums were more present. Sometimes they are absolutely present enough for my taste, and then at others, I think, sort of like I've said before, because of how many guitar layers there are, the drums can get overpowered at times, like during the densest parts of Overture. And I think that may be why I prefer Fly By Night and Richard Chycki's Signals over his 5.1 mixes of 2112 and Moving Pictures. And I'm not even going to go into Farewell to Kings because Stephen Wilson's is so much better, it just makes it irrelevant. And I'm definitely not even going to go into Hemispheres because it's just not listenable for me. So, in conclusion, 2112, an amazing album that has stood the test of time. I think the music speaks for itself. It's absolutely worthwhile picking up 2112 5.1. It spreads the music around you very nicely. It has a couple of minor detractions in just some of the mixing choices, I think, but doesn't really kill the effort for me. I enjoy putting this on, particularly watching the comic book. So I highly, highly recommend that you find a copy of the CD Blu-ray set or the CD DVD audio set while prices are still sane. And I just want to say, for those of you that have been grieving over Neil Peart's passing over the last couple of weeks, like I have, that for me, I feel like the pain is dissipating, and I no longer feel like I'm in shock, like I feel like I'm coming to accept that he's died, and I feel like I'm beginning to come to terms with just how hard his last few years must have been. I'm so glad that I read a quote from the band saying that he didn't lose his sense of humor all the way to the end of his life. That's very comforting for me because it says to me that he very likely had some enjoyment on some level, even up to the end. So I hope that those of you who have also been affected by his death are also feeling better and better. And you know what? We still have his works to enjoy. And in a way, I think they've become even more precious because we know there's going to be no more where that came from. And I think a great way to remember Mr. Peart is in his works. His books, his drumming, the music that we love. So thanks for watching. As always, you can support this channel by liking this video, subscribing, ring the notification bell, leave your comments below about 2112, about Rush and 5.1, Richard Chycki, Stephen Wilson, the awesome Terry Brown. Neil Peart's passing, or anything else that you'd like to discuss. I enjoy all of your comments, and it's part of what makes doing this channel fun. And for me, Peart's passing reminds me that life is short and life is precious. So let's live it to the fullest, and let's live life in surround.